Please find your seats.
Excuse me, everyone. Please find your seats.
Or should I just say, like, all right, welcome to Vespers?
Huh?
All right, okay.
All right, welcome to Vespers. Please worship with us as we sing.
Slowing down. Christ at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sin was white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you.
Our hearts long for to be overcome.
and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
Thank you, everyone, for singing with us. Please bow your heads as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful day. Thank you for everything you've made. Thank you that we're able to be here to worship together tonight. And please be with Drama as they bless us tonight. Please help everyone to be able to pay attention and to enjoy it. Your heavenly name I pray, amen.
Welcome to Drama Vespers. You guys sounded really good tonight. I was sitting up here on the front row and I could hear you and it was beautiful. So thank you so much for singing tonight. Before we get started with our Drama Vespers tonight, I want to invite Mrs. Garapi up, and there are a few members of the drama team. I don't know if they can hear me. Oh, there they are. I want to invite them to come up, and these wonderful drama students just wanted to take some time to express gratitude for Mrs. Garapi and her teaching and friendship and all that. So I'm going to turn this over to them.
We just want to say thank you for everything that you've taught us and being a great teacher, and we love you and support you.
You know, we gave you that duck because of, you know,
our chicken.
Because you gave to the chicken to the other person, so, you know, moment silence. Okay, that's enough. Okay, Josh.
Thank you for just being so fun and crazy.
We're a group that loses focus so fast, and thank you so much for always having the patience for us and for always getting us back on track.
I thank you because there are times when we are not doing what we're supposed to be doing, and you still just give us a gentle reminder and help us get back on track. So thank you.
I love you.
Okay. Thank you so much, just for your patience and your kindness, and for bringing drama in out of all of us.
I just like to say thank you because you're like my mom away from home. So, yeah.
I got you, fam. Justin, Jesus sash.
Still small voice. I feel like
we don't appreciate enough how blessed we are to be able to gather whenever we choose to come and worship you. And I thank you for that. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to worship you in different ways and using different kinds of talents. And I pray that tonight everything that is said and done will be an act of worship for you. Please let your Holy Spirit be with us this evening. Thank you, God. Amen. This evening we're going to talk to you about the theme of Keep Making Me. And it is comes from the song Keep Making Me by Sidewalk Prophets, which you're going to see in just a moment. And the idea is that we're a work in progress, that God is not finished with us yet, and that's okay, because he loves us in the process, and he's working with us through that. You can go ahead and change the slide. You see, we have these pictures of these different broken things throughout the program tonight, and this comes from the word kintsugi, which is a Japanese art of repairing broken pottery with gold-covered glue. And it turns the things that have been broken, you can go to the next slide, it turns the things that have been broken into something useful again, and also something unique and beautiful in its own way. And people have taken these things and turned them into works of art, and you can go on the next slide, and used it to inspire other works of art. And it just says something about the fact that even if we're broken, we can still be beautiful and we can still be used. So that's the idea that we're going with tonight, that we may be broken because of our own mistakes, or we could be broken just because of what life has done to us, but God can use us in our brokenness, and he can recreate us into something more beautiful and more unique and more special than we could ever imagine.
Can be healed, 'cause I'm so callous, and now I can't feel. I wanna run to you with heart wide open. Make me broken. Make me empty, so I can be filled. 'Cause I'm still holding to my will, and I'm completed when you are with me. Make me empty till you are my one desire, till you are my one true love, till you are my breath, my everything. Keep it.
you're about to see is called Life by me and Jeffrey. And it's about how when you fall and trip and, you know, mess up your life, that God will always be there to pick you back up again and, you know, make you better.
Life. We all have one. We all use it in many different ways. Take our friend Timmy here with his insignificant small bag of life. Timmy has a small life which he enjoys, but until he falls. How sad. But Timmy, life is ruined. Who can save him and help him get his life back together? Wait, who is this? It is Jesus. Has he been there all along? Jesus comes up to him. And Timmy says,
Jesus, can you help me?
And Jesus, behind his back, is a new life. It's not a puny, small life. It's a big life of maple and brown sugar. Friends, let us remember about Timmy. When our life seems puny and meaningless, we call on Jesus to make our life a bit sweeter and better.
Ms. Scarpy told us that we had to actually write skits. And that's very cool and all. And we went through the whole process of creating and like brainstorming and figuring out what to do for our skit and everything. And we heard that Pastor Litchfield was supposed to preach tonight as well. So Justin and I discovered that we basically had the same exact skit. We had the same concept, so we kind of combined it into one. And since the theme of tonight is Keep Making Me, our skit is of how others' words do not make us. It's God who can make us.
It also talks about how like words can be powerful, and that you can choose to either say the right words, nice words to people, or you can either choose to be hateful and just say the wrong words or negative words. But just know that people's words don't define you. It's God's words that define you.
So dumb.
You are not useless. I made you. I made you so well. You are valuable to me. You are not ugly. You are the apple of my eye. You are beautiful. And you are not worthless, for I bought you with such a great price. Sorry. You are special to me. And you are not dumb, for I made you so well, have free will and reason. You are very intelligent.
So the skit that we're going to do next is called The Singer, which is the one I came up with. Okay. So it's basically about this girl and that she thinks she has to be perfect for everything. But really, you just have to come to God. You don't have to be perfect. You just come to God as you are. And it doesn't matter what anybody else thinks. It just matters what God thinks, because he loves you and he made you.
So that was like, I mean, that was ridiculous, but it was actually kind of funny. Oh, guess what? So I'm finally going to conquer my fear,
which is,
you know, singing public. You guys know that.
That's great. What are you going to sing?
I'm going to sing a talent show. You guys going to do anything?
Well, we were, but we didn't get past the auditions.
Why? What was your little gig?
We were gonna sleep.
Oh, okay, all right. That, okay.
What? It's a great talent.
Right. Sure. Some peace.
You guys, you know what Annabelle's doing?
No, what?
She's joining the talent show.
Are you serious?
No, man.
She's definitely gonna mess that up.
Oh, man, she's gonna demolish any song she sings.
Yeah, how does she think she's so good enough to sing at the talent show? Yo, let's go to the right, guys.
Who am I kidding? I can't sing. Probably just gonna go on stage and make a fool of myself like I always do. There's no point in doing anything. Probably not even gonna do it anyways.
Hey.
What's wrong, Annabelle?
I don't think I'm gonna sing a talent show, guys.
What? Girl, you got a great voice.
I mean, I'm just gonna go up there and make a fool of myself.
Annabelle, you have a beautiful voice.
I mean, but I heard other people say things
like... It doesn't matter what other people say.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what they think. What matters is what God thinks of you, and he loves you.
It's not that simple.
Look, it doesn't matter what other people think. Just do your best, and God will bless.
Look, it doesn't have to be perfect. You just gotta be willing to let God use you.
Yeah, I guess. Thanks, guys.
Come on, we'll go practice.
Guys, so kind of I wrote a skit called Mirror Mirror on the Wall, and it basically is how there's a mirror, obviously, and sometimes when you look in the mirror, you think about all your flaws. Like, Sometimes you make mistakes, sometimes you fail a test that you study really hard for, sometimes you say things you really didn't mean to say, you wish you could take back, you know? But you have to realize that sometimes we make mistakes, but God's not finished with you yet. He has big plans for you. And although you may make mistakes, so does everyone else. And God has a plan for you, and when he's done making you, you'll do something great for him.
Also, I also wanted to emphasize on your guardian angel, because sometimes when you're thinking bad thoughts, your guardian angel is trying to talk to you, but sometimes you just don't let them.
Why am I so ugly?
Ew.
Why do I look this way?
It's all your fault. You have no one to blame but yourself. You chose this.
Is there something I can do? Is there someone that can help me to fix this?
No, you're stuck like this. There's nobody who can help you. You're garbage.
I smell like it too. I'm ugly. I'm worthless. Why isn't God helping me with this? What did I do to deserve this?
I'm pathetic. I'm useless.
You're right. Who could ever love you? You're so ugly and dumb. How could you ever believe that you matter?
Who can love me? I can't even love myself. How can you be saved? This isn't reality. This is not a movie. This is reality.
I'm worthless.
I am worthless.
God loves you.
If God loves me, why hasn't he fixed me yet?
Joseph waited 13 years. Moses waited 40 years. And Jesus waited 30 years. If God is making you wait, you're in good hands.
So, you're saying God's not finished with me yet?
Of course not. God has big plans for you.
Don't give up yet. It's not over. Greater things are coming, and I know it's hard to remain patient, but hang in there. It gets better.
But how long would it take?
God knows how long you have waited, and it'll all be worth it in the end.
So what do I do now?
Trust him. It doesn't matter what other people say about you. Just trust him and God will give you the courage to stand strong.
But how do I come to him?
Just come as you are.
All right. Does any one of you played with something like that was your favorite toy, and then your dog just or your pet just like runs in there and just destroys it, and you're like, no! And then your parents is like, what happened? My Legos or whatever is fallen, and they're like, oh, okay, this is that again, but. You know, we do that in life, you know. We just build up on stuff, worldly stuff, and then just Satan just collapses it all. And then Jesus is our Father. So this skit is called Messed Up.
Mom! I messed up my cookie!
this up. I'm gonna be on top of the world, guys. Woo! I think I know. Whoa, that was pretty close, you know. Okay. And all I have to do. No! Dad!
What is it, Thomas?
I broke it!
It's alright, I'll fix it. Hold on.
Oh, man, this is not good. Whoa. Thanks, Dad!
Excellent. Excellent. Thank you. So real, so true. And really, there's two groups of people in this world. Thank you. Those who deny their brokenness, and those who admit their brokenness. Those who deny their brokenness, those who admit their brokenness. Nordstrom's, I've never been there. They say it's quite an exquisite department store. I don't think they charge admission, but it's pretty exquisite. And the story goes like this. There was a lady who liked to observe people shopping, and it was Christmas time, and she was over to the side on the floor where all the luxurious dresses were. The elevator doors open, and in walks a bag lady from the streets. And the lady's going to watch this because she knows security's going to be there any minute to usher her back to her homeless streets. She goes over to the rack of dresses, and the lady's watching. There's piano music playing. The lady watches as she goes through the dresses, and then she sees it happen. She knows this lady's shopping is almost over because a very dignified sales lady starts walking over to her with great direction. Madam, may I help you? Yeah, I'm looking for a dress. Well, this is a nice one. It goes well with your eyes. Or how about this one? It blends well with the lovely hair you have. Yeah, I think I'll try those two and that one. Thanks. Where's the dress changing? Thank you. She goes over. She puts on the dresses. She comes out. Her sales helper says, oh, that looks lovely on you. I'm sure the other one will too. And the lady repeats three times. The sales lady continues to be as dignified and as other-centered as you've ever seen. The lady comes out after trying on three dresses. I changed my mind. I don't think I want any of these dresses. The sales lady reaches into her pocket, hands her a card and says, madam, I'm honored to have served you. If you choose to come to this store again, please ask for me. And the lady walks out, takes the elevator and goes home, or wherever she goes. Tony Campolo was telling that story once, and a guy from the back came up, handed him his card. He was a rep from Nordstrom's. And he said, I would like you to come, write up the story,
every time there's an orientation for employees, we want that story told. I don't know the lady's theology. I don't know if she was a vegetarian. I know nothing about the lady. But I know this. Repetition for effect. Romans 5:5. When God pours his love into us, it will flow out to others. When we've experienced the tenderness of God, we will be tender with others. And when we're not tender with others, that doesn't make us bad. It just means we got to go get reconnected and focused. You said that in so many different ways tonight. And you exaggerated, and that's good because that makes us understand the points better. The Bible's full of this stuff. There are so many voices yelling out for us. You should be successful. You should be ashamed. You'll never amount to anything. Oh, so many voices, but there's one other voice. It's a still small voice, and here's what it says. You are my beloved, in whom I am well pleased. That's the voice we need to hear. But to hear that voice, it takes something. It takes solitude, silence, and a strong determination to listen. I won't show it to you tonight. Maybe half of you have already seen it. But go to YouTube. There's a lot of gospel on YouTube. I know there's junk too. But maybe you've seen it. Relax, I won't tell it to you. It's called The Stuttering Comedian. This guy was playing, yes, I will tell it to you. This guy was playing softball, and he got injured. And he started to have a very heavy stutter. And he turned into a comedian. But there was one person in his life, his girlfriend, who was supporting him, encouraging him, worked three jobs so he could get whatever it was, American's Talent or Idol, whatever. I don't know which one it is. And the guy got on there. And he did a couple of his routines. And you know the judges. They were amazed. The entire audience stood, ovation. And whatever it means, he pushed the button. You're going straight to Radio City. And it shows his girlfriend, who to me represented God, just crying her eyes out. Because if there's one person in a person's life, you are Jesus. You are the red mark. You are Jesus. I don't know what they called him before he was drawn from the water, because that's what Moses means, drawn from the water. And here was this lovely princess going for her morning devotions. She was going to worship the Nile. Maybe you would too if you lived in the desert. Oh, Nile. Thank you. Thank you for your water. Thank you for your life. On the way home, she passed a frog. Oh, frog. I mean, those crazy Egyptians worshipped everything. I'm glad we're not like them, aren't you? Yeah. And Moses grew in stature and in favor with God for a while. God was always in favor of him, but Moses still had his crazy free choice, sort of like us. And I don't know if he was strutting around. Maybe he was kind of, I don't know. But we know what happened. We know we saw two people fighting, and he was in his royal garb, probably said, hey, quit the fight, quit the fight. And I don't know if he picked up a stone or what, but as he broke up the fight, he kills a guy. Not exactly just a broken toy, but he kills a guy. And the next thing we see is Moses on the I-95 out of Egypt. Nobody's picking him up. Fast forward, 40 years. He's been working with sheep, the dumbest animal to come down the pike. Guess what we are? I just want to be a sheep. Bah, 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 bah. And so one day he's walking in the wilderness. You've heard the story a million times. He's walking with the sheep, leading the sheep. And over out of the corner of his eyes, he sees a bush. Just spontaneous combustion, a lot of desert heat out here, and these bushes do all kinds of crazy things.
walking around, and then he hears, Moses? We're talking about a broken man here. Moses. I don't think he said, you're talking to me? And he went over. It's one thing to see a burning bush. It's another thing to hear a voice from a burning bush. It's a third thing to talk back to a burning bush. And that's what he did. What's the first thing he heard? Take off your shoes because you're on holy ground. So he does it. But he's broken and he knows he's messed up and he's got a voice. He's got a voice saying, you're no good, you killed someone. You're no good, you killed someone. You see, the beauty of God is he doesn't see us as we are. He sees how we can become. And the beauty of God is he does have selective Alzheimer's. He does let things go and never remember them again. That's what the scripture says. The biggest person that gives us problems when we mess up is ourselves. The preacher usually starts talking about, we must love our neighbors as ourselves. Then he goes on about loving your neighbor. I believe that. But you must spend just as much time on loving yourself. That's not narcissism. That's not looking at yourself. That's not being self-centered. There is some proper self-love that we have to have. And you guys said it when you said, well, you didn't say the words, but I thought of it. God does not create junk. You are God's original masterpiece. Remember that one? The skit guys. You are God's original masterpiece. And so Moses is standing there and the bush doesn't burn up and he knows this is a God encounter. And he didn't know this was going to happen today. He didn't say, oh dear God, speak to me today. He's just out there with the sheep trying to not step in the sheep stuff. And he, God says, Moses, throw down your staff. Okay. It's a snake! It's a staff! It's a snake! And then Moses did a very dumb thing. I don't know if you know much about snakes. I don't spend time with them. I run the other way. I call it a garter snake, call it a black snake. They're all deadly. And Moses picks up the snake by the tail. Not too bright, Mo. And it turns into a staff. God says, put your hand in your robe. Yeah, God. Got it. Take your hand out. Gross! Leprosy! What is this? Oh, okay. This is not desert heat. This is you, God. No, I've been to Egypt. Been there, done that. I'm slow of speech. Yes, Aaron talks very well. All right. New story. Peter says, I will never betray you. Super disciple, you know me. I will never betray you, God. You know. Though they'll all leave you. Peter. Satan wants to sift you, but I've prayed for you that when you get it together, you'll be with me. And you know, Jesus goes to wash his feet. You're not washing my feet, Jesus. No. If I'd been Jesus, I would have thrown the water and put the soap in his mouth. But Jesus doesn't act like us. I wish by the power of God. Romans 5:5, when he pours his Holy Spirit into us, then he will act in us to will and to do according to his good pleasure. And so then Peter says, well, bathe all of me. Get between the toes. Get under the, bathe. Peter. No, Peter. You've already had your feet washed. You're already apart. Now catch this. It's very important in the story. You want proper self-worth? You want to get over your brokenness? You want to get over the messes in your life? Then here's something you've heard all your life, and it is true. As Jesus staggered to the Garden of Gethsemane, We're told that Peter or James and John, he was holding on to them as he got to his spot, but he still wanted to be alone. He said, "Will you guys stay over there and what? Pray." If Peter had prayed and not fallen asleep, there would have been maybe 14 crosses, or maybe God wouldn't have had an angel come down, because it's the only time we have where Jesus asked for little earthlings to pray for him, and they slept. And Jesus wasn't ticked, but because he went over to him and said, "Hey man, I know your spirit is willing, but what? Flesh is weak." Listen to this now. If Peter had prayed, this next part of the story I would not have to tell. Because you remember all the miracles. They came, the angel did come and strengthen Christ, and Christ discouraged him, and despondency and depression left him. And then the thugs came, Jesus kissing him on the cheek, and that was nothing strange. That's what they did in those days. Jesus accepted the kiss and said, "Betray the Son of Man with a kiss." And then they tied Jesus' hands. That's no miracle. We tie Jesus' hands all the time. And then Peter, here he goes again. "Hi, what's your name?" "I'm Malchus. I'm the high priest's servant. Could you tilt your head like this, please?" Because if you're not feeling good about yourself, you trash and cut others. Remember that. When you're not feeling good about yourself, you take it out on others. Next time someone messes with you, just say to them simply with a smile on your face, "You're not feeling too good about yourself, are you?" I think that's biblical. I don't know. Jesus never said it, though. And Peter goes like this. He's aiming for the center of the head. He misses the center of the head, gets the ear. Peter goes, Jesus' hands are tied with a guard on either side. And here comes miracle number two. Doosh, doosh. Jesus does not ask the guy if he's a believer. He doesn't ask if he has faith. He doesn't even wait for someone to send her. He reaches down and picks up the ear. Gross. Jesus does what he has to do. And then he turns to Peter and says, "Peter, if you live by the sword, you're going to die by the sword." And in my imagination, Peter lets that knife fly, hits an olive tree behind him. That's Jesus' belief on violence. I won't go through the whole Old Testament now, but when I have some problems with the Old Testament, I don't rip it out and throw it away, but I go to the clearest picture of God. Hebrews says Jesus is the radiance of the Father. And what did Jesus do? No violence, Peter. And that doesn't exactly go along with your father's counsel, boys, when he sent you to school in second or third grade, and he said, "If a kid picks on you, you just got to hit him." Nice father. But I'll say to your face, Dad, that ain't the approach. "Well, you'll get taken advantage of." "Oh, you mean like crucified? God helps those who help themselves." That was Ben Franklin. But here's the part I love the most. Jesus has now been taken to the court. Peter's warming his hands by the fire. Girl comes over to him and says, "Hey, weren't you with him?" Cuss, no! "Hey, sounds like you have the same accent." Cuss, I don't know the cuss man! And as that rooster crowed, check Desire of Ages, there's one full page. Jesus cannot say a word, but apparently they caught each other's eyes. And look at the body facial message that Jesus sends to Peter. Look it up. He's hurt. He forgives him. He loves him. It's okay. He said it in his face, in his eyes, with all the other stuff he's going through. God is looking down because Peter's low self-worth isn't doing too hot right now. And then you know where he went. To the very spot. There was no rock there, please. You know that picture hanging from your grandmother's wall with the rock and And Jesus is like this with a little halo behind his head and every hair in place. Nice grandmother, nice wall, but incorrect. Jesus' fingers were digging into the dirt. He was feeling further and further removed from the Father. And Peter went to that same spot. And visualizing what he had just seen with Jesus in his love and acceptance. Not this. Oh, Peter, you badmouth cusser. Please. Look at the ways we deal with people when they're messed up. And look at the way Jesus deals with people when they're messed up. Look at the discipline Jesus laid out on Judas. He was the first one to have his feet washed. Look at the low self-worth of the little small guy that climbs up in the sycamore tree. He's loaded with ripping people off of money, but he wants to see God, and he's been thrown out of the church, which didn't just mean you couldn't go to the synagogue. You couldn't go to Home Depot, Walmart, nowhere. You got nothing. You're walking around like leprosy. The kid's already got a low self-concept because he's so short. And God stops at the foot of the tree. I don't know if he knocked on the door. Desire of Ages says, Zacchaeus got up in the tree because he wanted to see who Jesus was. King James says, he couldn't see him because of the press. Get it? The press. Don't ever confuse God or the church, because when you've been thrown out of the church, God comes up and knocks on your sycamore fig tree and says, hey. He didn't say, you crooked rip-off tax collector. He said, hey. He called him by his name. You know what his name means? Pure. Pure. You and me would call him pure crook, but that's what mom named him, pure. And then God and Zacchaeus walk to his house. God goes to his house. Maybe God even walked like this as they went to the house to come to his level. That'd be just like Jesus. Final story. And it's another Campola story, and it moves my heart, and it goes right along with your theme. Someone says, don't ever say you don't believe in purgatory unless you've been to summer camp. He says that a physically and mentally handicapped kid went to camp. And as he'd walk across the campground, there'd be three kids mimicking him. Before you ever make fun of anybody, or especially a physically or mentally handicapped person, get a crayon and cardboard and hold over your head, I am ignorant. And you know already from Scripture that when you're messing with God's people, remember what God said to Saul on the Damascus Road? Why are you persecuting me, Saul? You mess with his people, his handicapped kids, you're messing with God. And if you're messing with a handicapped kid, you're showing your brokenness so clearly that you have no self-concept, so you're trashing the weakest one, just like the lions do. They go for the smallest, weakest animal to kill. And he says, he goes up to one kid, where's the craft shop? And the kid mimics him back, that way! It was their cabin's turn to have the worship. And these guys thought it would be so funny to get this kid to do their worship. And so they went to him and said, hey, tomorrow morning is our turn to do the cabin worship. We'd like you to give it, okay? Can't do it. And the kid goes like this. I'd be glad to give the worship. I can do it. And they thought it was going to be the funniest thing that happened at camp. And the little kid came up to the front of the camp bowl, and the kids all filled up the camp outside bowl. And his little buddies over here just laughing, poking each other. And he's oblivious to them. Very important. Don't ever look at people. And that's what we do. We look at people. General psychology, Cooley's Looking Glass Self, Psychology 101. We get how we are by how people respond to us.
That's why if you're a committed Christian, you're looking for people all over the place to encourage, to build up. We need to catch people doing good and gossip about it. And this little kid gets up and he says, takes him a long time to get it out. I love Jesus. These kids have stopped laughing. Here comes the second line. And Jesus, he loves me. Yes, he does. And Tony Campola says, the Holy Spirit just descended on that little camp ground. And the kids were crying. And there were kids making decisions for Christ and what they were going to do. I love that song that we sang tonight. I love to watch the way these kids were singing. They actually sang it like they believed in it. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. And it is. Don't get uppity. But I've been checking you guys out. This is a safe place for Christians to grow. It isn't perfect. It's a safe place. But I'm sure we still hurt each other's feelings. Any one time you live together, burp together, sleep together. I mean, yeah, sure, there's stuff going on. And when that happens, you have the God-ordained Holy Spirit baptism guts to go up and say these three things. I usually say this to the couple when I'm doing premarital. Say these three things. I'm sorry. I was wrong. Duh, please forgive me. What a concept. I'd finished telling that story once at a Washington Pathfinder campery, an outdoor campery. And as I finished, coming down the hill was a kid walking like this. And I said to myself, dear God, what have I done to this kid's self-worth to tell this story? And he comes up to me and he says, I like the story about the camper. I like the story. Guess what, saints? We're all handicapped. We're all broken. And if you think you're hot stuff, you're the most broken of all. In fact, it's just a facade. So whatever you do, do not go by externals. Do not go by the happy Sabbath that you'll say to each other tomorrow. And don't just say, oh, I had a busy week. Wouldn't it be neat if in church we were actually authentic? And we would say, how was your week? And they give you the standard stuff. No, how was your week? Tell me a story. Because before you ever preach the gospel by the power of God, you've got to listen the gospel. Jesus was such a good listener. Relax, we're not going to have a healing service, but I want to say this. If there's anybody in this room that needs forgiveness, that needs healing, that needs to put something right, then don't wait for December 31st or January 1 to do that. Just Nike, do it. Pick up the phone, write a letter, go see someone. Well, what if they don't accept it? That's none of your jolly business. You just do what God calls you to do. And you know what happens afterwards? It feels good. Restoration, repentance feels good. That's the way God wired us. Two ideas for you. Number one, take the book Steps to Christ. Make sure it's yours first. Read it over and over. If there's a real Christian around you, say, hey, let me share something with you. Steps to Christ. That's exactly what it is. No, I know. You don't achieve a relationship. You receive a relationship. But breathing is important in growing in Christ. And so what you do is you get the title, get the chapter titles. Don't start at the beginning of the book. That's ridiculous. You go to the chapter where you are. And you read that chapter. Now, once you've done Philippians for 15 days, then you shift gears into the the Gospel of John. That's going to take longer than 15 days. It's the life of Christ.
That's what everybody says. Read your Bible and pray. Haven't you got some new material, Pastor?
Breathing is important. That's breathing. And guess what? You'll see from your own experience how God's ways satisfy you. And here's the last promise. I'm trying to stop. I call it the he promise, Philippians 1. He who has begun a good work in you, this goes along with your stuff, will continue his work in you until he gets you off this popsicle stand. I mean, that's not exactly what it said, but that's until he comes to get you. So it's not you. It's him in you. Hey, thank you. Thank you for making the gospel come to life. Do not grow weary in doing that. It's good. I'm sorry? Oh, mime. Okay, there's a mime now. Okay.
From the biblical times to modern day. Now, we all face things in life where we might lose our purpose and lose the meaning of who we are. But Jesus is always there to remind us who we are and help us find the way to heaven.
To the nobodies, to the abandoned, who couldn't see and the pain was a plan. Looking back now, Lord, I can say thank you. Now let me tell you who I am.
How do you do? I am a sin, born into sin and shaped in iniquity. Now I believe, not who I was, but still not what I shall be. You found me and gave me your name, and things I decided have changed, but inside your seats, still broken pieces, deep in me, reaches for you. How do you do? I am a beg.
That means I'm
desperate for more. I hunger for your truth. See, I am shattered,
broken.
And though I may fall, still you make all things new. You speak the story, it obeys, and gone is the weight of mistakes. And though I still feel, you continue to heal. Look close and see.
I am
so far from perfect. I thought life was worthless until you showed me who I am.
Don't forget your
not here by mistake.
Yes.
No luck, only grace. I'm on my way to who I am.
Now called your son.
I am
forgiven for what I've done.
I am
forgiven for what I've done.
I am.
Yes.
Thank God I am
sealed by your grace.
I am
still here. Help me say.
Of you, I am.
I'm in love with you.
I am.
It'll work.
worship you.
Jesus, we praise you that we're your child, we're your friend, we've been forgiven, we're a member of Christ's body, we're a saint, we've been adopted, we have direct access to you through the Holy Spirit, we're complete in you, and we're free forever from condemnation. We love you. We've been talking about you this whole evening. We've been singing to you. You're such a good God. You're such a good God. Love you. Can't wait to see you. May we give you a God day today. In Jesus' name.